Hi, in this video I will give you an overview of how you can communicate with a database from ASP.NET Core. I will provide a basic example, so let's get started. So in this basic database communication example, I will use the new ASP.NET Core. It is a web framework from Microsoft. And it's cross-platform, so you can create web applications for Windows, Mac OS, and Linux. If you are new to ASP.NET Core, I suggest these following basic ASP.NET Core videos. You can find them on my YouTube channel. So this is the example we are going to create in this video. Just a basic example. We are going to retrieve some data that are stored in an SQL Server database. So before we start creating our web application using ASP.NET Core, we need to create our database in SQL Server. Let's go to SQL Server. So we'll use Microsoft SQL Server in this example. Of course, you can use another database from another vendor. But since SQL Server is made by Microsoft and Visual Studio is made by Microsoft and also the ASP.NET Core framework is made by Microsoft, all these things are tightly connected and it makes it more easy to create an application where the programming language, the development studio, Visual Studio, and the web framework and the database is made from the same come from the same vendor. So we'll use SQL Server. SQL Server comes in many flavors. For this basic example, SQL Server Express is good enough. You can download it from free from internet. So let's start creating the database, assuming you have installed a version of SQL Server. So let's first thing we need to do is to create the database itself, and then we will use the SQL Server Management Studio, which is part of SQL Server. It's a separate installation package, but also this one is free and you can download it from internet. So we need to start to create a database. In my example, I just name it Measurement DB. Then we need to insert or create the necessary tables. In this basic example, you only need this basic table called measurement. It has three columns, the primary key, measurement ID, it's just a running number. So I'm using this identity 11, which means it's automatically increased by one each time we enter data into this table. And then we have a measurement name and a unit. So it's a very basic table that we will use in this example. So later we will use this table in order to retrieve data from this table into our web application. So you can use SQL Server Management Studio in order to just create this table from this script, or you can enter or create the table manually in SQL Server Management Studio. We also, when you have created the table, we also need to create some initial data. So in this basic example, I have just used again the SQL Server Management Studio in order to create or insert some basic values into this measurement table. So here I just enter the measurement name, temperature, and the unit, humidity, percent, etc. And then the measurement ID will be created automatically by 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Because this value is automatically incremented since I have used this identity 11 here. So that's the database. So now I open my SQL Server Management Studio. I have my SQL Server database here. I have created the measurement DB, my database. In order to create a database, you can just click on databases create new database and enter a proper name for your database and click add and OK. Then this database will be created, and under table you create your tables. Here I have two tables, but in this example we only need this one. So in order to create a table, you can click new query, and then you can enter the SQL statements as shown in the PowerPoint, or you can right click here, table, in order to create a new table from scratch. Just enter the column name, data types, etc. And then we need to enter some data into the table. Then when you have created the table, then just right click, edit top 200 rows. And then you see I have already entered some data into my table here. But if you add, so you just click here, enter the measurement name and the unit, and then you click enter in order to insert the necessary data into the table in this database example. I can also use a query to see the data in my table. Select all from measurement. Click the execute, and then you see this is the data in my database. I can also, instead of this symbol, I can use the column directly, measurement ID, comma, measurement name, comma, unit, like this, and then click execute. So this query, we will use this query later in our application that we create in Visual Studio and using this ASP.NET Core. So that was our database. Now we need to use Visual Studio. So if you don't have Visual Studio, you can install Visual Studio, a free edition of Visual Studio. Just download it from internet. Then next, when you have Visual Studio installed, you need to create a new project, and then you need to select the ASP.NET Core web application project. As mentioned, ASP.NET Core is a cross-platform framework from Microsoft that works on Linux, Mac OS, and Windows. And you can choose between different programming languages. We will use the C# programming language. And when you have selected this template, in the next, and then you click next here, then you need to select. You can of course select an empty template, but it's easier to select this web application template. So just select this one and click create, and your web application project will be created. So let's see how we can do this in Visual Studio. So now I have opened my Visual Studio, and then I just select create a new project, select this ASP.NET Core template. So this one, the ASP.NET Core web application template, which can be used on Linux, Mac OS, Windows, and we are going to use the C# programming language. So select this one, click next. And then, select this one. And then next we need to select a proper name for our application. Since we are going to create a basic measurement system, we can call it measurement app or something, measurement application. I just find a proper place on my hard drive. I just have a temporary folder called development, which I select. And then we click create in order to create the application. And now I am asking, they are asking for this web application template. So I just select this one, click create, and my Visual Studio project will be created. It contains of some predefined folders. We have the pages for our web pages, we will use something called the Razor. So we will here later create a Razor page. We should also create a C# class for our database communication. This should be typically be done in a folder called model. So let's create a new folder and then call it models like this. So now we have a folder for our web pages and we have a folder for our C# classes, and here we will create a class for communication and retrieving data from the database, and here we will create a web page that present these data on a web page. So let's start creating the code for our application. But first, I just mentioned that we are going to use something called ADO.NET in this example. There are several ways or different frameworks we can use to communicate with a database from an ASP.NET Core application. We have something called Entity Framework. But the core way to either retrieve or insert data into the database from Visual Studio is this ADO.NET. So we are going to use this one in this example. So this ADO.NET is the core data access technology for the .NET languages, and it can be used in all kind of applications as long as we're using this .NET framework. So either if you are creating a web application, desktop application, etc., you can use the same ADO.NET and the code will be more or less exactly the same. So that's an advantage by using this framework. So part of this framework, we have this what you call a provider, because with ADO.NET we can communicate with different database systems. If you want to communicate with an SQL server from Microsoft, we typically want to use this system.data.sqlclient provider or namespace. So we will use this one in our example. Typically we need to use this NuGet package functionality, which is part of Visual Studio, in order to retrieve the necessary package. So we'll see how we can do this later. So first, typically, let's start to create the database class for the communication with the database. So we have already created the models folder, which we are going to use to store our C# classes. So in this example, we are going to just create a class called measurement.cs, where we are going to create the basic code we need in order to retrieve data from the database. So now we are back in Visual Studio. So in our Solution Explorer, we just click on the models folder we just created, add a new item, select a class, and then you can call it measurement. Like this. And click add. And then this class will be created here. So it's just an empty class. So let's start to create the necessary code in order to communicate with our database. So in order to save some time, I've just copied the necessary code and I will explain it in detail. But first, as mentioned, we will use this namespace. So using system data and SQL client. So that's the necessary namespace we need in this example. And let's see the code here. So the code gives some errors here. So the next thing we need to do is to insert or add this NuGet package. So let's create or insert this NuGet package. We select project, manage NuGet packages, and there we have what the packages we have installed, and then there is no packages installed, so then we need to browse for it. System data, and then here we have this system.data.sql client. So this is the NuGet package we need in order to communicate with our database from our application. So we just install it, click OK, accept. So now is our NuGet package for the system.data.sql client installed, and then you can see here on in the installed folder. In the installed folder we have this necessary package installed, and then we can go back to our measurement.cs class, which we have put in this models folder, and then you see now all these errors we had earlier is gone. So now our code should be working. But let's go through the code. So first thing we needed to do was to include this namespace, and then install this NuGet package. Then we need to create a class, and then in our case we call it just measurement. And then we need to define the same properties as we have in our database, which is the measurement ID, the measurement name, and the measurement unit. So we are going to retrieve the measurement ID, the measurement name, and the measurement unit from our database. Then we are creating a method called getMeasurementParameters. Of course, you can call it whatever you like. So this method will be used to create the necessary code in order to retrieve the data from our database. So we want to return a list of measurements. So we want to have a list of all the records in our database. So this is list measurement. So we are creating this list of measurement. We call it measurement parameter list, and just create this one. And then we need to create the connection string to our database. Then we have the data source, which is the name of your SQL server. UID is the username. By default you have this SA user, it's short for system administrator, but you can of course also create your own user, but this is the default user if you install SQL Server in a default way. You have the password for the SA user. Typically you are asked for this password during the installation of your SQL Server Express. So then select SA or another user, and then the necessary password and the database. Here is the name of your database which you created in SQL Server Management Studio. In my case, I call name the measurement, the database measurement DB. So then we have the connection string ready. We create a new connection using this command. So SQL connection. All this code is part of this ADO.NET framework. So we create a new connection by using this SQL connection. Create a connection and a new SQL connection, and then the input or argument will be this connection string. Then we create a query in order to retrieve the necessary data from the database, and then here select measurement ID, measurement name, and unit from measurement. So this is our table and this is our columns. Here, these are our columns inside our database. As you see here in the Measurement Studio, we have the table, And then we have three columns, measurement ID, measurement name, and unit. Next, we need to open a connection to our database. Just use this connect object you have created and this .open method. Then we need to create a SQL command using this syntax. And the input arguments here is this query we have made here and the connection we made here using this connection string. And then we can start to retrieve data from the database using an SQL data reader. So you just create an object called DR for data reader. You can of course use another name, and then we create a command dot execute reader. Since in our case we are only retrieving data from the database, we are not storing any data, we are just retrieving or read data from the database, so then we can use the dot execute reader here. And typically a database consists of several records, so we need to use a while loop in order to retrieve one record inside the loop. So then inside this loop we will retrieve one record at a time, and then we will put this record into this this list we have created here on the top. First we just need to check that the connection is okay and that the data on the data table consists of data. So we check if it's not equal to null, then we go into this while loop. We create a measurement parameter object in order to retrieve one record from the database. So then we use this object measurement parameter dot measurement ID, which we have defined here on the top, equals to DR measurement ID. So we are using this piece of code in order to retrieve the value inside this column in our database according to this query. And since this is an integer, we just need to convert it to an int like this. And the same here with the next measurement name. This is a string, so you just need to use two string in order to convert it to the proper data type in C sharp. And the same with the measurement unit. We retrieve the value from the database and we convert it to a string. And in each loop, we add this record to our measurement parameter list, which we have defined here. And then when there are no more records in our table, the while loop will be finished, and then it will return this measurement parameter list which we have here. So this will be a list of data from our database which we will present on our web page. So the next part now is to create the web page itself that present the data from the database in the web page. We are using ASP.NET Core, and part of that we need to use something called Razor. So we are going to create a web page called measurement.cshtml. That's the name of the file. And this ending is the default name used in ASP.NET Core. CS means it is a C# file, and HTML means we are creating a web page. So that's the measurement.cshtml file, but also in addition, part of this ASP.NET Core, a so-called page model file or code behind file is created in the same time. So in addition to measurement.cshtml, a measurement.cshtml.cs file is also created. So this page model is just a C# file with C# code, while this is the web page itself containing HTML and this razor syntax we are going to use. So let's create this measurement CS HTML file in Visual Studio. So back in Visual Studio, we use this pages folder, which are used to create our web pages. By default, there are some index file, etc. This index is the default startup page in ASP.NET Core. We will create a new one called measurement. So then we just click new item, select razor page, a razor page with a page model. This is what we are going to use. I'm calling it measurement, like this. Measurement. Click add, and then this new web page will be created in the pages folder. And as I mentioned, here is the web page itself, measurement.cshtml, and then here we have this page model or code behind file called measurement.cshtml.cs, meaning it's a pure C sharp code file. And by default, this code file looks like this. It has some default namespaces. Typically, we don't need those, so we could remove them, or you can add more if you need more namespaces. So you just leave them as they are. And by default, we have this onGet method. This method and the code inside here we are going to create will be executed when the web page is opened, or when we retrieve the web page from the web server. ASP.NET Core will go into this method and execute the code we are put into this onGet method. So we have already created our model, which is this measurement.cs class, where we have used ADO.NET in order to retrieve data from a database. And now we need to get that data into the web page. So I just copied the necessary code in my onGet method. In addition, we need to add the namespace for our model. So using, we have called it measurement app dot models. So this line of code, make sure we get access to our classes and methods we have created in the models folder. So the first thing I'm starting to do here is to create a list of measurement, and I call it measurement parameter list, like this, and I make it public because we are going to use or need to get access to this measurement parameter list in our web page later. So that's here we define the measurement parameter list and we make it public. And then we make an object of this class we have made here in our model. And we use this object we have made here in order to retrieve data from the database and use the method we have created here in the measurement class. So then use just measurement dot get measurement parameters, which is the name, or sorry, the method we have created here. And this method are going to retrieve data from our database and return it in this list. So then we are using the method in order to retrieve the data. So that's all we need to do in this page model file or code behind file. So you just save it, and then we can go to our web page itself, this measurement.cshtml. So here this file contains of a mix of HTML, which is the default, you could call it, programming language on for creating web pages, and then we need to mix it with a so-called eraser syntax in order to get the data we want from the database. And this at page means that we are linking this web page to our code behind file or page model. And since we have made this public, we should be able to have access to the data from our web page. So in order to save some time, I just copied the code, but I will explain it here. So everything that is between this symbol and this symbol is what we call eraser code. So the first thing we need to do is just have a title on our web page. I just call it measurement parameters, like this. And then next I need to create the web page itself. And in our case, we are just going to create, let me show you the example we are going to. So this is the web page we are going to create. We just have a header. And then we are going to create a table where we retrieve the three columns from the database: measurement ID, measurement name, and unit. And then we will present this table in our web page. So then I just created a div in order to put my HTML code. I use this h1 to create the header of my web page. And then I use this table in order to create a table where we are going to retrieve the data from the database. And this table should have three columns: measurement ID, measurement name, and unit. So this is defining the columns. And then next I will use some eraser syntax. You see that this is eraser syntax by this at notation. So we are going to use a for each in order to retrieve data from our list and put it in our HTML table. So we just use at for each, and then we define var measurement in, and then we are using something called model. So this is used as part of the eraser file in order to get access to the data we have retrieved here from the database. And since we put it public, this measurement parameter list will be available here as part of this model. So model.measurementParameterList, make sure we get access to the data we retrieve from the database. And then we want to create this table line by line. So then we are creating this measurement, and then we can use inside each of the record, we can create this table by using this TD as part of this table notation in HTML. And then you can use at measurement dot measurement ID, which is this one, which we have defined in our measurement class. And next, which is the measurement name, at measurement dot measurement name, which is the same here, measurement name, which is part of our class. And finally, at measurement dot measurement unit. So we are using a mix of C# code, eraser code, and HTML code in order to retrieve data from the database and put it into an HTML table. So basically, that's all we need to do. We have created our class, which are used to communicate with the database using this ado.net. We have created a page model or a page behind code behind file where we are retrieving data from the database using this get measurement parameters method we created. And then we have the web page itself, where we are using this razor syntax in order to retrieve the data from this this list and put it into a table. So let's just run the application and see what's happening. We click on top here in order to run the web application. So by default, ASP.NET Core, this template, creating a header and a footer, and it has this startup page, which is this index file. Of course, we can change the contents here, but in addition, we created this measurement file. So we just here in the URL, we enter measurement and click enter. So we just had our URL here, and we added measurement, and then, as you see here, this measurement.cshtml file will be presented here, and the data from the database will be presented in this HTML table. And you, as you see, data here is the same as we have in our database here. So this is the data we have in the database, and the same data are presented on our web page like this. So now we just need to enter measurement here, but we can also include our measurement web page in the header here. So let's see how we can do that. We just shut down the application, and then here under pages, in addition to our measurement file we just created, and we have this default index, under shared here we have what we called underscore layout, and this file here we define the overall layout for our application. And then you see here we have this header, and in the bottom we have the footer, and in addition this layout also include different libraries like the Bootstrap, jQuery, etc. But let's just add or change. Let's say we don't want to have this privacy. We can just change it to measurements like this. And then instead of privacy, which is this file, we want to have this one. So then you can just call or enter measurement here. And then measurement like this. So let's run our application now. And click on this one. And then our application will be opened in our default browser. And then you see we have this measurement here. And then we can click on this one. And then our measurement web page will be opened. And then we can go back to home. And then we have this index file. We can go back to our measurement, etc. So now we have created a basic ASP.NET web application. We have been able to retrieve data from a database in our web application. But let's make some improvements. One of the improvements we want to make is the way we store or use the connection string. So in this example, we just hard coded the connection string in our C# class, but typically in ASP.NET Core, and this kind of information is stored in a file called appsettings.json. This file is created by default. So typically we should use this file and save the connection or store the connection string inside this file instead. So here you see an example of how this appsettings.json could look like. This code here is just the default code created, so you can just leave it. But in addition, we should add our connection string. Typically, we can have multiple connection strings, but in our example, we only need one connection string. So this connection string needs to have this name, but our connection, this is the name of our connection. We could call it whatever we like. I just call it connection string. But you could have another name here if you want to. And then we have our data source. This is the name of the SQL server. UID is the user for your database. By default, it's SA, but you could create your own user and the password for that user. If you are using the SA user, the password, you are asked to create a password during the installation of the SQL server. And then finally, the name of the database. So you just replace this access with the information from your database. So when we have added the connection string to our appsettings.json file, we need to update this meshment.cs class, which we have created in the models folder. So it doesn't need much modification, but we just remove the hard-coded connection string, and then we use or add the connection string as an input to our get meshment parameters method. So that's the updated meshment.cs file. And then also part of ASP.NET Core, we have a startup.cs file, which also are created by default. We need to add some information to it. The information we need to add is this services add singleton I configuration, etc. So this, we just need this piece of code in order to be able to read information that is stored in this appsettings.json file. So you don't need to understand it, you just need to add it in order to make it work. And then finally, we need to also update the code for this meshment.cs html.cs file. We need to add the connection string here, and we need in the constructor here, we need to create the constructor, and then we need to use or add this piece of code just to make sure we are able to read from this JSON file. So just add it exactly like this. You don't need to understand the detail here. You just need to have it in order to be able to read from the configuration, this JSON file. And in addition, in our onGet method, we need to use this underscore configuration, which is created here, dot get connection string, and then the name of the connection string, which we have here in the, so this is the name of our connection string. So we need to add it like this, and then put it into this variable. And then in our get measurement parameters method, we just have the connection string as an input like this. So back to our Visual Studio application, then we have this here. We have the models and pages, and then we have this appsettings.json file. And here we have the connection string. We enter the connection string for your database. So that's the configuration file. And then next we have this startup. And then we needed to add this this one in order to be able to read from the appsettings.json file. So that's, you just add this one in the startup.cs file. And then in our pages, we have this page model or code behind file. We just add the connection string here, or create a variable called connection string. And then we have this piece of code where we just make sure that the configuration we are able to read from the configuration file is appsettings.json, and then we are using this one in our onget method connection string, and then this underscore configuration dot get connection string. That's the method we need to use, and then the name of the connection string, and then we use this variable as an input to this get meshment parameters. So if you run our application now, you shouldn't be able to see any differences. So the application looks exactly the same. You have this index, which you can change, of course, and you have the header and footer here, and then you can click here in order to open my measurement web page, and then we retrieve the data from the database and put it into this HTML table. But now instead we are using, we have put the connection string in this JSON file instead, and that's a better approach than just hard code the connection string in your class. So that's how you create a basic application in ASP.NET Core, and you can use the ADO.NET framework in order to communicate with the database and retrieve data. So that's all. So good luck with your programming. If you want to learn more, you can go to my webpage, www.halvorsen.blog. Here you find lots of resources regarding programming in general, industrial IT, automation, and of course also lots of information about ASP, Visual Studio, C# programming, and this new web framework called ASP.NET Core, which we have used in this video. Thank you.